Gonna do some Christmas decorating on my railroad today. And what I'm going to do is hang some Christmas lights on the eaves of this house and make it look a little bit more Christmassy in a few other ways too. This is just a cheap house kit. I think it was either Lifelike or Model Power. It was two pretty much identical houses in the same kit. And it's a really simple kit to put together. I didn't glue the roof on, but I glued everything else together. It's literally the base piece, the walls, the chimney cap, and the roof. Super duper simple. And all I've done is on the side that's going to be facing the aisle, just for this demonstration anyway, I've just given it a light ink wash weathering to pick out the bricks and the other three. So that's actually the fancier side of the house anyway. All the other sides are just looks like a stucco, and this is a brick finish. So I give it a bit of a wash just to pop out the groove detail in between the bricks there. And that's enough of that. So now I have to think about how to put lights on the eaves of this thing. The eave, or just underneath the eaves where it fits together. Hang on, let me just snap the roof back on. You can see that there's a fascia board underneath there. Let me just snap that down. There we go. You see underneath there that it's a fascia board, and one under there too. And I think that's where I'm going to put my Christmas lights. I'm not going to run them all the way out to the edge. I'm going to leave them underneath there a little bit, just so that they're not quite as blatant, a little bit more subtle. And since, again, since this side is the side that's going to be facing the aisle and theoretically the street, I'm just going to light there and then back in there. Okay, what this is some plastic fiber optic that I took out of a cheap plastic fiber optic flashlight toy thing that I found at a surplus store, actually Value Village, I think, really. A kid's toy, basically. However, I've taken some of the individual strands out of it, and when you hold the end of it up to an LED. Let's see if I can do that here. You see that point of light on the end? That's the basics of what I'm going to do. I'm going to run those up from inside the roof and just stick those at the end. But to make the point of light a little bit bigger, I've heated the end of it, the end of the plastic fiber, to give it a bit of a mushroom on the end. You see that? And there's what it looks like with the little mushroomed end. Much brighter, a little bit more defined. So that's what I'm going to be doing. I'll be mushrooming out one end of these fibers. I'll be drilling holes in the eave here to accept those, and I've actually already done this one at the end here. I'll show you how I did that, but and threading those through there, just pulling them in like that. I'll zoom back in and focus that, and then there's kind of how it's going to look under the eave of the house. So, when I do that, then I'll just have to route all these back into a bundle inside the house and connect them up, bundle them together, kind of like that. And actually, I might start from, well, no. No, I won't. I'll bundle them all together in a piece of heat shrink tubing and then shrink that around an LED, or possibly more than one LED, and that should get the light out there. But then I'll have a light source in the middle of the house, and that's not going to work out very well. So I need to build a couple of walls in there just to make a utility room in the middle, essentially, that's invisible, that's kind of hiding that light. So a few things to do. First thing is to decide how far apart I want these things. Where's my H? That's O. That's HO. So I think, let's zoom in on that again. That's that front wall. It's not in focus. So I think if I put them 1 HO scale foot apart, that should be a good balance between actually making them fit and being able to do it and not looking like just a single bar of light. So I'm going to crack on with that, and then I'll start preparing the fibers. So I'm just using my knife to mark the positions, and I'll come back later and drill them out with my little drill. There's all my marks made, and now I'll just take my pin vise and a drill bit that's just a hair bigger than those fibers and drill through the eave at each of those marks, which only takes a few seconds per. All right, there's all the holes drilled in the eave. Now, to prepare the fibers, and I've cut them out of the base thing that they were in already. And so, as I mentioned before, let me just do a bit more zooming back in here. As I mentioned before, you just gently heat the tip and it mushrooms up just like that. So I'm going to do that a bunch of times. Doesn't take long. That one's already done. Okay, here we have all the fibers. Next job is running them through the holes. Which is a little bit fiddly. But it goes if you persuade it. And like everything in this project, repeat it a bunch of times. Okay, there's the last one in. Gonna nudge those guys into the holes a little bit. Now, to figure out a way to make them stay there. I could use model glue, but I don't know exactly what it's going to do to these. I think I could use CA glue too, but again, I'm not sure exactly how these things would react to that. So I think I'll just use plain old white glue and drop some in behind there, and we'll be good to go. I squirted a bit of white glue out onto my little gluing palette board here. It's got the residues of 100 glues on it, so I'm not too worried about the fact that I made a ridiculous blobby mess. And I realize that white glue isn't the best glue for plastics, but this isn't going to be under a lot of stress, and it is one of the most benign glues that I've got around here. It's not going to cause problems with the fibers. Okay, so there. I'll just let that dry and come back to this eventually. While that's drying back there, we can prepare a couple other things. I mentioned that I want to build a wall in here just to create a utility room for the lighting so that it's not shining out the windows. So, I need some plastic. I mean, you could use any number of kinds of plastic, but I'm going to use the cheapest plastic I could find, which is this. It is still styrene, but it's obviously super duper affordable when you can get it as surplus material. So I'll just mark the size of the floor that I need, approximately here, and cut that out. As the usual method of cutting thin sheet stock, I'll just mark it approximately with my ruler. Line that up over there. And make this more or less parallel. This is just eyeballed. This is not going to be seen. This is just going on the inside of this little house. So I don't have to be super super duper precise. Just use the lines of my cutting mat to approximately eyeball this. And I'm going to have to adjust it at some point anyway. So, okay, it fits in that way. Doesn't fit that way because of this. And that notch is in by about that much. So where's that mark? That mark is there. How's that looking? I'm gonna take a little strip off this side. Not, and I could do this a lot more precisely. But this isn't, as you've heard me say before, this isn't a contest model. This is just a fun little model project for my layout. So I'm not going to be too stressed if it's not perfect when viewed from an angle that I don't intend it to be viewed from. There, close enough. However, nobody's got a bright white floor in their house. Okay, after digging through my paint supply, I've decided that sandstone was the color that I'm going to put on my 1970s floor. Why? I don't know, seemed like a good idea at the time. Which in retrospect seems like how most color schemes in the 70s were decided. Now I'm not going to do. I actually might want this streaky so it looks like a pattern on the floor rather than looking like just painted. And again, you're only going to see this through a window from a long distance off. So it's not going to be super duper critical whether it's a specific pattern that you can recognize or not. Just enough of it, enough that it's, you know, not glaring white. Just going to let that dry. You know, let that keep drying back there. What else can I do? Oh, yeah, I also cut another piece of that plastic out to make a dividing wall in there. And again, I don't want it to be glaring white. So you need to come up with something to decorate that wall with. And I thought it might be wallpaper. Again, it's not going to be seen. It's going to be halfway back in the house. But, you know, it's, you want a hint of wallpaper. So something that I like to use for cheap wallpaper is these envelopes. This stuff out of the envelope. That's decoration. And I think this blue circle-y stuff from the bank. Oh, there's a slightly different one, a different one again. I think I'll use this one, though, as my wallpaper. And all I need to do is just, you know, trace around that with the knife. I'm kind of running out of room on my cutting mat here. I'll do it over there. Ta-da, wallpaper. That I'll just attach to there somehow. Wish I was more prepared. Okay, pause again. All right, I have just the thing. A glue stick from my kid's craft stash. Perfect. Just gob some on there. And stick her on. There we go. Just wipe the squeeze out off. Which has now got my hand stuck to this paper towel. Okay. So once the floor goes in, that will go in there. You're looking in through the windows. Look kind of like that. Except for it's going to be dark in there. So you'll just barely see it anyway. But it creates a view block. And in behind there, I'm going to take a couple more pieces of the same plastic and just make a little room so that I don't have light shining out anywhere. So I need my little room to be about the same size as that, the same height as the other inside walls. Yes, it's approximate. Now, what I need to put inside my utility room is basically going to be just the LEDs and the fibers. So here we go. That's going to go like that. Those can just go in there like that, and I can tape them together, glue them together, whatever. And that'll create a sort of a lightproof box, so I don't have my LEDs shining out the back and the sides. I'll probably tape that together, but I'm gonna wait until everything's dry here before I carry on. So for now, I'm gonna pause and I'll come back in a while or one edit later. Time has passed, things have dried. So here's my floor. Tuck that into there. Looks reasonable when viewed through that. Here's my interior wall. It's, again, when viewed from there, that's not bad. I think I'm gonna have to poke a hole in my floor though to let some wires in with the usual precision used in areas that are never going to be seen. That ought to do. I think I do want to trim that down a little bit though, so that it will sit flat. That's reasonable. I think from the back side, I'm going to tape it down though, just so that it's going to provide a bit of a light block. I'll just mark where it sits. And tape that down. And I'll probably use some black electrical tape just to act as a more of a light block. That's easily done. And again, this isn't structural, this is just to block the light out, so I don't completely ruin the illusion here. That'll do. Okay. Now then, I'm going to do these in two different colors of light so that the lights show up in two different colors. And I have chosen from my assortment of LEDs red and green, nice Christmassy colors. So I'll just bundle these into basically an odd and an even bundle. Tweezers might be useful in this. And that one. Come in. I'm just going to cut a couple of strips of tape to help me keep these out of trouble here. This is going to be a bit fiddly. So have I done this correctly? I think so. There, that's... Okay. Now then, that has to be nudged over a little bit, but those two should both fit down into there. May have to nudge it a little bit more. There. So now then, I'm just going to line these up with the shortest one in the bunch and chop them all off even. That's not going to work. Let me get it. There we go. Now then, I'm going to want to bundle those all together and put the light on the end of them. So I think I'm going to use heat shrink. And I think that size will be adequate to shrink down over my LEDs. I'll just knock off a chunk from my bin here. Chop it in about half. And the trick is going to be getting those all in together. And I think actually I'm going to do this in a couple of goes. One just to bundle the LEDs or the fibers together. And then the second one to actually shrink the LED on and hold it. Okay, man, get in there, you. I want that pretty close to the end. And just pull that down with... Hopefully these lighters have enough gas left in them. Uh-oh. Oh, that's not good. Ow, 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 ow. Okay, now this is going to be tricky. And actually, Maybe I'll try and just do a little bit of a pre-shrink against that. Just to sort of hold that in place. Then let that firm up a bit. The astute among you may have guessed that I'm winging this. I haven't actually done this before, so we'll see what happens. That's a result. Oh, I missed one. I missed a couple over in here, actually. That's why that bundle's bigger. Oh, well. I guess Buddy changed some bulbs at one point in history and didn't get the right colors. Ooh, his wife's going to be grumpy at him. Okay, some are dimmer than others, but I wonder if that is partially to do with the alignment of this LED. It's a little bit brighter. Okay, next step, I guess, make this all fit into here. Get those LEDs to fit down through the hole into the basement. There's the roof back on, and the interior, and from the street you're not going to see the difference. Okay, now do a little bit of wiring. While I had the camera shut off, I stripped the shrink off the green LED and re-shrunk it on there so that it's sitting a little bit straighter, which made the light come out better. Still not brilliantly bright, blindingly bright, but that's okay. I'm not too concerned about that. I also did a little bit of math. I'm planning on powering the lights from 5 volts because I'm going to have 5 volts everywhere on the railroad. So 5 volts with an LED with about 2 volts, 1.9 something volts of drop across it. Did a bit of Ohm's law magic and came up with about 150 ohms, and that's what these two resistors are. Now I could just put those in parallel, and use a single resistor. But if there is some variance in current draw, I don't want one to cause issues with the other one, so I'm going to use two separate resistors, and I'm going to use them on the positive side for no other reason than, I don't know, tradition, comfort, something like that. Let's trim those back a little bit. Let's pre-tin those. And the reason, I think I've talked about this before, but the reason to pre-tin it is so that there is solder sitting there waiting for you, so you don't have to carry it on the tip of the iron. Oh, there's my other loose bit of solder. Always clean your tip every single time. This makes the heat transfer so much more pleasant. Now then, all I have to do is hold it in there, transfer heat on there, melt it in place. One done. Okay, I think you can see my lights. They're not perfect. So what my problem is that I haven't done a super duper good job of lining up the LEDs in there. If I was using LEDs with a flat face, those top hat LEDs, that would get a better alignment across a wider number of my fibers. If I was using larger LEDs, that would also hit a wider variety of them. But, okay, so we're not in current limiting here. We're drawing 39 milliamps. Right, which makes sense because I chose for 20 milliamps on each LED. So, I don't know. That seems reasonable enough. Especially for a background effect on my railroad. Okay, the house itself needs a bit of work still, but I think the lights came out not too bad on there. If you get down at the right angle, you can see those ones underneath there. I'm not convinced that I needed to put those on there, but I think these look pretty good. Certainly a good idea, anyway. Well, I hope that gives you some inspiration, if nothing else. I think it's a cool effect if it's done with a bit more skill than what I applied it with. I just did a quick and dirty version, mostly as a proof of concept and a demonstration. So, hope somebody gets inspired by this and does an even better job of it. And if you do, post your video and put a link in the comments. I'd love to see it. Thanks for watching. Talk to you later.